The way it will go, I think you're going to present one framework, and then each team is going to work on the set of questions, present to the audience, and then we're going to move to the next framework. And our judges sitting in the back will be giving you comments.
Yeah, so I'll go through quickly the agenda quick, just so you see it. So what I wanted to do is just set up a framework for you guys to understand how things work, and we'll go through an hour sort of presentation, Q&A, that kind of thing. We have a questionnaire that builds upon the framework, which we'll distribute and give you guys half hour to just work on that. And then for the last 90 minutes, what we'll do is have you present those, and then we'll give you feedback on those, okay? So this morning, John did a good job of outlining how to start with why. And so what we want to do is carry on from that and say, well, we're starting with why, but now what do you do, right? So what I've presented here, or I'll present, is this framework called connection-based selling. And it's a framework that helps you work through how to construct and create your pitch, right? And I don't mean that into an investor pitch. I mean that as to somebody who will actually buy your product. And I'm thinking about this more in a B2B setting than sort of a consumer product or something like that. But the decision process is quite similar. So the underlying part of all of this connection selling is that at the end of the day, people buy from people, right? So we're not robots. We don't think about speeds and feeds and, you know, benefits and all those things. The reason that we start with why is to create that compelling hook, right? That will create us to create some sense of urgency of why we want to buy the product, right? So we trust people who care about us. And so in order to get through and break through in that sales process, you really have to create some level of trust with whoever's buying your product, right? You're selling to a person, right? And so a couple ways that you can create trust is we tend to trust people. This is more psychological research than it is sort of business or technology or market or engineering, but we tend to trust people with a common worldview from us, right? So you can think about if you meet somebody at a cocktail party and you start talking and you tend to think about the same things and tend to think about them the same way, you'll start to create a bond with that person, right? Likewise, if somebody actually cares about me, I have more incentive to trust them. So if I'm struggling with something in my business and you come along and you understand deeply what that problem is and how you can solve that, that's how we create this connection, and that's why we call this connection-based selling. And we trust people who listen to us, right? So one of the greatest things that you can do if you're at a cocktail party is just ask questions and listen. Most people, especially in America, right, is that we ask questions and then we wait to talk again, right? Rather than we ask questions and really care about and listen to what the person's saying, right? And let them talk more than us, right? And especially when we come in with a pitch, we want to just give our pitch right away. But really, if I'm buying your product, like, I don't really care about your pitch. I have other problems to solve, right? So where's the company that did the code that makes mobile apps? Are they here? No. So like, I would be a buyer of that software, right? And I don't want to hear your pitch. I want to hear about, okay, I know the specific problem I'm trying to solve, and I know you're in the right area, but how do we connect that? So what tends to happen is people make an emotional decision first, and then they rationalize it with all the data, right? So they have to, when they create a want, then this, yeah, you can see this in sort of consumer products and retail, right? You see a pair of shoes or you see a sweater or something like that, and you like it, you just want to buy it, and you feel compelled to it. And then you rationalize, it's like, well, you know, this will save me money, or I had this old sweater that I had to get rid of anyway. And so people start creating data and stories to rationalize these decisions, right? And so in creating that emotional connection first, that's why we start with the why, and then we start filling that in with the data to rationalize and help that person come to sort of reconciliation with that decision. So an example of some rational things are things like, you know, you might have a cheaper product, right? It might be better quality, or it might be faster, or it might have better features, or it might not break as often and last longer. Those are all good things, right? But none of those are compelling, to be honest with you, right? They're compelling if I have one of these problems, right? But you don't know what problem I have, truly, right? Unless you're selling me something that I already have, right? So if you're selling me, if I have product A and you come out with product A prime that's, you know, cheaper, better, whatever, that's still not enough. Because like, now I got to go change it. I got to get rid of that. There's somebody who's probably trained on that product, right? I don't necessarily want that based on some of the rational explanations. But these emotional things are different. And that's tapping into the individual buyer's want, right? So things like, maybe just have a beautiful product, right? It's a consumer product. It's well designed, right? It's just something beautiful that I just want to have, right? Or we talked about nostalgia earlier, right? How that it creates that, you know, going back to the old times and creating nostalgia, right? One of the other companies we talked about, fairness, right? Control is another one. Like, I'll give you an example. I'm in charge of mobile development for the company that I'm at right now, and an analytics vendor came in and said, you know, at the end of the day, they were saying, oh, we have better reports and we have this, and you can slice and dice data this way and that way and show this pretty visualization. I don't really care, right? Like, that's just more work for me. I already have something. It's fine. But then they were like, they hit me on this control item, right? Which is, you will have more control over your product and then you will feel in control of what's happening if you know what's going on and people are using things day to day. And I was like, as a product manager, I'm like, oh, that kind of makes sense. It's like, I want to be in control. I want to have the answer. So when somebody comes to me in marketing or they come to me in sales, you know, I want to feel in control, like I have the answer and I'm the smartest guy in the room, right? And so this goes to this concept of really making me feel like a hero. Like, I want to be smarter because I have your product. I want to be cooler, easier, like better looking and taller and all of these other things, right? But it's this idea of making me feel like I'm empowered and I'm a hero for buying your product. I'm the smartest person for buying your product, right? Because, or I'm the first guy to have your product, right? Because that makes me the smart guy. It makes me the thought leader. It makes me something that it awakens this emotional connection, right? So this concept of starting with why, awakening an emotional need, is all about what we call connection-based selling, right? So the first step in it is to make people care, right? Like, why are you even having this meeting? Like, why do we even come together today, right? So why should I even care to have this meeting, right? And that's sort of like that hook, right? The next thing is, give me a reason to change, right? And people change for really two reasons. We tend to change, and this is psychological research again, is that we tend to go to things that give us pleasure or do things that avoid pain, right? So if I don't adopt your product, maybe I'll look stupid. Maybe I'll lose my job, right? Maybe you know, my competitors will come and eat my lunch, right? So that's the pain avoidance reason, but then you can also do the pleasure seeking, like I'll be a hero, or you know, I'll be more charismatic if I buy your product or whatever. And then the product really is what I perceive it to be as the buyer. Really not what you're telling me, because it may or may not work the way you're telling me, but in your pitch, I'm creating a mental construct of me using that product, how it's gonna work, right? How am I gonna adopt it? And so I'm creating that mental model, right, in my head. And so that's why so much of it is this emotional buying and then logical justification. Right, I'm really just thinking what's in it for me a lot, right? People buy associations as much as they buy solutions, so they might want to be just associated with your product. When John was talking this morning of Mass Challenge, a lot of it is when people sponsor Mass Challenge, they really want to just be associated with the good that they're doing, right? They don't necessarily need to know how much ink they're going to get or whatever, right? When John said how they adopt his product, then they ask, oh, so what do I get? Right, that they're buying that association, right? And then the final point here is make sure you're selling to the right person, right? So just because you get a meeting at a company doesn't mean that they're the right buyer, right? So we'll go through this. So this is the framework, is really 5 points here. So the first starts with the hook, right? And we did this morning, right? We walked through that this morning, which is that golden circle to spark interest, right? And gain opportunity. So the hook that we talked about this morning, that just gets you in the door. And I think a lot of the questions this morning were, well, don't we still have to show the product justification? And it's like, yeah, we absolutely have to do that. But the hook gets you in the door, right? It creates the opportunity for you to tell your story. Without it, I don't know, I mean, you might get introduced or you might get something like that, but you really just hooked that person. Maybe we met at a cocktail party or something and you've hooked me and I said, yeah, come into my meeting on Monday. Come into my office on Monday, let's meet. The next thing is about making it personal, right? So learn about, again, people buy from people, right? So learn about the buyer as a person. Like, what's his title? Who does he report to? How is he compensated? How is he incentivized? All of those types of things. We'll go through each of these in more detail. You know, what are the pains and what are their business issues? And then how have you connected your solution to their pain, right? So that it's valuable, right? Maybe you're gonna save them, you know, some amount of money on their budget and therefore they can spend that on something else, or maybe you're gonna make them more money and then they're gonna get a bonus, right? So it's trying to create that quantifiable value proposition. And then the fourth thing is to make that credible. So if you tell me you built a teleporter machine, I might say, yeah, I have a problem, you know? I have to travel on planes, so I'd love a teleporter machine, and like you've hooked me on like transportation, and yeah, it could be valuable if you did that, but is it credible? No, right? So how do you back up some of the claims you're making, right? So if you tell me you're gonna save me $1 million, like why do I believe you, right? What benchmark, customer references, things can you do to support your claim? Because what you really want me to do, in most of these enterprise sales, like there isn't really just one decision maker, there are many, right? And so what you want to do is make me your champion to take, when you go away, I have to go sell everybody else in the organization, right? And so that's about having a clear next step and determining the decision-making landscape, who's involved, right? What are they going to buy? What are the resistance to buying? And how do you actually close that sale? So we'll go into each of these in more detail, but any questions generally first? You guys know this.
So for a startup, it's tough to get customer references in the very beginning.
Sure.
So how do we solve that?
So the first thing you have to do is, so there's a couple ways you can solve it, right? One is that you can put it into the negotiation up front, so you can give them special pricing or something like that in exchange for a reference, right? The other way you can do it is make them really successful and valuable, right? So if you have made me a hero in my organization, and then you come and ask me, he's like, hey, will you talk to this guy for me? I'll be much more inclined to do that if your product actually worked and was successful for me and connected to me on the emotional level. Like if it just kind of runs and I bought it and it's installed, but I kind of don't use it, or somebody else in the organization uses it and I don't really check on it, I'm really unsure, I get middling results, there's no way that I'll give you a reference, right? But if you've checked in with me, you've created the relationship, you understand my needs, you check in to make sure that it's working, you go the extra mile, that tends to be the way to get like the customer references, right?
But again, it's not about credibility. I don't have credibility, I just, you know, it's kind of trade-off between pricing.
So give me an example. What's your company?
For example, I want to sell something to AT&T. Okay. They don't buy without references.
Right. So references can come a different way, right? So if you're asking for AT&T to be your first customer, good luck, right? Like that's a very difficult slog, right? I mean, it's not to say it can't be done, it can be done, right? But you're gonna look at it a different way. Another way you can think about references is that, how did you get that meeting in the first place, right? How did you get in the door to meet the person that you're supposed to meet, right? Maybe a high-powered investor referred you in, right? Maybe you have a great advisor, right? And you're leveraging their credibility to you, right? So those are kinds of the things you want to do. I mean, you have to think about is that enough, right? I always think about it as there's this chasm from where you are today to what you're saying you're going to do. And I have to fill that in as a buyer, and I have to believe all of those steps that you're going to take to get there, right? And so those things all help a little bit. They bridge the gap a little bit, but I still have to make a mental leap, right? So who is it in the organization that's willing to make that kind of mental leap, right? Is the kinds of things to think about. But yeah, AT&T is your first customer is a tough one, right? We can talk about that later. Anything else before we'll dive into these in a little bit more detail? We good? Okay, so the hook. This is a little bit of a replay of what we looked at this morning, but I when I saw John's presentation, I couldn't help but give you this clip to augment a little bit what he talked about. I don't know if you guys are familiar with the show. It's called Mad Men. It's from an American show, but it's about an advertising agency back in the 1960s. And just to set up this clip, the advertising agency Kodak came in to the advertising agency and had a slide projector. So this is the 1960s, right? And the slide projector had, rather than having the old slide projectors, you had to like feed them in, right? One by one and manually kind of feed in slides, right? In this long strip. But this came in, they came in with a wheel, right? And it would, to them, it was like the greatest technological innovation, right? So let's go ahead and play it.
No Eastmans today, unfortunately. They're all back in the lab.
It's a wonderful facility, but they don't take vacations.
What do they show? Slides of them working?
It's just set up anyway.
So have you figured out a way to work the wheel into it?
We know it's hard because wheels aren't really seen as exciting technology, even though they are the original.
Well, technology is a glittering lure. But there's the rare occasion when the public can be engaged on a level beyond flash. If they have a sentimental bond with the product. My first job, I was in-house at a fur company with this old pro copywriter, Greek, named Teddy. And Teddy told me the most important idea in advertising is new. It creates an itch. You simply put your product in there as a kind of calamine lotion. But he also talked about a deeper bond with the product. Nostalgia. It's delicate. Potent. Sweetheart. Teddy told me that in Greek, nostalgia literally means the pain from an old wound. It's a twinge in your heart. Far more powerful than memory alone. This device isn't a spaceship. It's a time machine. It goes backwards, forwards. It takes us to a place where we ache to go again. It's not called the wheel. It's called the carousel. It lets us travel the way a child travels. Round and around, back home again. To a place where we know we are loved.
We can stop it here. It's good. You want to stop and then we'll flip back. So the general idea is these guys came in with what they thought was the greatest technological innovation, the wheel, the ability to take this one by one feeding slides and have it in a continuous motion, right? And Don Draper, who's the pitch man in that, saw that and said, yeah, we can pitch speeds and feeds and pitch it like a spaceship, but we can pitch it more like a carousel, tapping into this really deep, nostalgic view of coming back to childhood. I mean, the way he connects it, right, makes you feel like it gives you goosebumps, right? Like it makes you feel and like you're connected to this product that would otherwise be, we can put, 72 slides in a continuous fashion and rotate, right? But here it's taken a completely different approach. Now you're hooked. Now you want to learn. Now you want to. Now you've opened up the conversation that you can have about how that works. It's like, okay, this is great. Now how does it work? Tell me more, right? And so it's about that hook, right? It's about, as he says, creating that itch that you have the solution to, right? So if we jump ahead. I don't think this is working. Okay. Let's jump back. So that's the hook in the golden circle, and we've talked a little bit about that, but I just wanted to bring it back because I think that's the first step in the process, right? Is that now you've opened up that conversation. So you've given them the why, right? And you now have permission, you now have the opportunity to really talk about what it is your product does and how it works. So the next part is how to make it personal, right? And this, especially in a B2B context when there's probably multiple decision makers, hundreds of thousands of dollars, like it's not the kind of thing that you come in one meeting and I write you a check and we're done, right? There's sales and there's all the things that happen in order to close the sale and there's lots of support and things that happen along the way of that relationship, right? So you have to make that personal connection. So the first thing is, who is the buyer, right? Who's actually going to be the person that writes that check for you? What's their role or responsibility in the organization? What motivates them, right? Who do they report to? Why are they, what reason do they have to buy? So if, you know, the native app company came to me, it's like, I'm in charge of mobile development, right? So all of that mobile strategy, mobile product reports to me. I have the authority to write that check, right? But why do I want that, right? What is it going to do for me? I got other things, I got developers, I got other things happening. Like, you need to change the way I'm working today. You need to give me a reason to change the way I'm working today in order for me to adopt your product, right? And so how are they compensated is another question, right? Because if I have a personal incentive to increase revenue because that means I get a bonus or something like that, then if you can tap into that, that's much more powerful, right? You need to make sure that, you know, when that revenue has to hit, does it have to hit at the end of third quarter so that I get my bonus and all these other things, right? And how that actually connects to me, because then I'll work harder for you, right? It's not about just creating organizational value. It's like I'm working for myself at that point, right? Which is another motivating factor. And then uncovering what their real business issue. And so I've put up a couple sample business issues here, but like what business issue are they wrestling with that they need to solve? You may come in and say, I have something that's cheaper, and it's like, I got budget already. I'm not worried about it. Like, I don't need to save money, right? That may seem odd, right? Because like, who doesn't want to save money? It doesn't work that way necessarily at big corporations, right? Especially in government, in the US, the way it works is, they get a budget that year, and if they don't spend the budget, they'll reduce it the next year. So if I have $1 million budget for something, and I only spend 800,000, they're like, when they redo the budgets next year, they're like, oh, you were able to survive on 800,000? Well, guess what? Your budget is now 800,000, right? So part of that is like, maybe I don't want to save money. That's not the driver, right? Cost management, reliability, time to market, all of these types of things, right? These are just samples. So the key here, you can't just walk in and say, tell me your business issue, right? it's something that you may not be able to articulate, right? So the key here is to ask questions, right? And really think about and really ask different types of questions. So there's three types of questions to ask. One are open-ended questions, things like, that help you, can you tell me about what's happening, right? Not things like yes, no. Right. Don't start with, do you want to buy my product, right? It's about understanding and opening up the conversation, getting them talking, getting them understanding it. Remember, we talked about the trust issue, right? Of how people will connect to people that they trust. And the way to build trust, one of the ways to build trust is to listen to them, right? So you have the permission because I'm interested in you. So you have the permission because you've hooked me, right, from the previous step. You're now in my office. We're talking about it. I'm opening up to you, right? I'm telling you things. And you should be thinking about, Okay, what's happening here? And you're listening, right, to uncover what their real business issue is. And then probe, right? When they say, you know what, it's really hard, you know, we got so much going on, you know, there's no time. It's like, well, tell me, like, is that because you don't have enough resources? Is that because you don't have enough budget? You know, those types of probing questions will get you deeper, right? And then confirm. So make sure you play back and you understand. Don't just assume you know. It'll be like, so Alex, so you told me that you're really busy this time of year and you're wrestling with things because you're telling me you're under-resourced and understaffed and all that, right? Now you're getting to a business issue, right? Where he's trying to achieve something, but he's at risk of achieving it because he doesn't have enough resources. That's his business issue, right? So now that we've understood the business issue, now how does that connect to create value? How does your solution map to what their issue is, right? And so the way we do that is we try to ask why, right? And we look for unrecognized problems and how do you solve those? How does your solution connect to solve their particular acute problem? And it's not the problem that you want them to have, it's the problem that they actually have and they're wrestling with. Because if you can solve that, you solve their pain, right? And the key here is to, once you can find that match, is to figure out how do you quantify that value proposition. So if you're saying it's saving me money, I'm wrestling with things and I'm under-resourced, and if I had more resources, I would be doing better. And you come in and you say, well, I can save you money so that you can actually go and hire a new resource to do that. If I can save money here, you can go spend it there. Well, how much are you going to save me? Are you going to save me enough for an entire headcount? Or is it somebody, you know what I mean? So you have to quantify that. You have to put it into real dollars so that I can actually use that. If it's about time, well, how much time will you save me? Is it, can I do it twice as fast? Can I do it three times as fast? Right? And so again, you open, probe, confirm. That's the way you ask questions, right? So you can ask, I put some samples here, is that how would you measure this payoff, right? How does this impact you personally, right? Because we want to create value, both the rational value, the quantifiable value proposition, and then the emotional value, right? It's going to make me feel, you know, better. It's going to make me smarter. It's going to get me my bonus, right? Something like that. And so the end of this stage is really you're probing to understand how that relates, you know, get digging deeper, and then you're confirming to say, which is saying, if we could save you $120,000 and you could hire a new person and you could do this, would that be enough for you to make a, like, buy the product today? So maybe we've quantified it, we've got something that you think is good and we're all liking it, but the next step is I need to believe you, right? And so let's say we've created all these connections and I believe you and I'm good with you. I need something that I can take around, right? You need to make me your champion within the organization, right? Because chances are if you're selling big ticket items, right, I need to get some approval, right? Or somebody else in the organization might be affected by the decision I make, right? There might be other users of the product where I'm the actual buyer, right? And so they're gonna ask me questions. And just because we had this nice conversation, you told me about a carousel, and like I was all emotionally involved, maybe I cried, right? That's not enough, because now I have to tell that story to somebody else, right? And I don't have your passion, I don't have your, I connected with you, but I need some hard things that I can take around, right? And show people, right? So I don't have to hook people within my organization, right? They have to listen to me because either they report to me, right? But at the same time, there might be people who can veto the decision, maybe the finance person or the accounting person, right? So what do you have, right? What are your assets? So case studies, customer references, we talked about that. Do you have benchmarks? I think, you know, one of the companies yesterday put up a benchmark of how well they did. You know, that's an example. Maybe you won an award, right? Maybe you're the Mass Challenge finalist or finalist winner. Now, if I did see a finalist winner come through, I've already assigned them value because I figured somebody else has vetted this. They've gone through a major process of vetting, so I'm going to listen to them. They probably have something important to say, right? Likewise, use your relationships, your investors, your advisors, people that you work with, right? So if you are backed by Y Combinator, right, you obviously have access, like I'll take your call, right? Because somebody else has vetted you and I'm assigning their vetting value to you. Or maybe you went to a prestigious school or something like that, right? Some of these things help. Again, none of them, there are very few silver bullets in this world that solve everything, but they all are about creating some level of credibility, right? Because at the end of the day, I have to be your champion internally. You're not going to be there. Selling is going on for your product when you're not there. And so now it's about clear next steps, right? So the way to think about this is that there's two types of power here, right? So one is the power in me to make a decision or buying decision, and who else has to be influenced in that to make that decision. But it's also power on the salesperson side. And you guys might not run into this quite yet because a lot of you are selling yourselves, right, as founders or CEOs of the company. But when you have a sales force and you actually grow a sales force, what if you have the junior level guy promising all kinds of stuff that's going to affect engineering and affect support and make product enhancements and things like that, right? You probably don't want that happening, right? So does the power in the salesperson to allocate resources to close the deal, right? Is the right person at the sales process at the right time, right? So the key here is to uncover what the, on the, so the second, I'll drill into the first one because the second one is kind of obvious. So in the first one, here are some ways that you can kind of uncover who, what the decision-making landscape looks like. Who's the buyer? Who are influencers to that decision? Who are their stakeholders in that decision who may, if I make the wrong buying decision, they're going to have to live with and they're going to complain to me, right? And then also, who could potentially veto that decision? Maybe finance can say no, right, to the decision. I might be enthralled. I might be saying, this is the greatest thing since sliced bread. It's going to save us $1 million over 2 years, but it's going to cost us 20 grand today. It's like finance might say, well, we don't have 20 grand right now. That's a great justification, but we can't write that check today, right? We just don't have enough money. So looking at that and saying things like, you know, maybe I come to you and I say, hey, I don't have budget, right? And then you come back to me and said, if you can get more funding, would that be enough to make a decision, right? So things like that to understand who's in the decision-making landscape and who's the actual buyer and what who can say no. And so finally, just to wrap this up, is some of the other things just to keep in mind, just to pull this all together is, you know, just respect time and deadlines. You know, Rich yesterday had come in and said, you're gonna start a sales meeting. And the first thing, or a pitch meeting, but this goes for sales as well. He said, how much time do you have today? You know, just understanding that time and deadlines. And if you're rambling on about stuff and I got to go, it's just awkward. And I probably don't want to, and if you're that guy, I probably don't want to have you come back at my office again, right? Knowing their business, right? So I get lots, I'm now on a company that actually, so I used to work for companies at startups that were selling to big companies. Now that I'm at a big company, people are trying to sell me stuff all the time. Right, I probably have like 5 emails from since I've been standing here that are cold that somebody's been trying to reach me to buy something, right? They know nothing about my business, right? They're like, oh yeah, this is great. This is a great software tool that does this and that, the other. Like, how do you know that I'm even the right person for this, right? You're just sending out a cold email, right? So knowing their business, and it's about creating that bond, that trust, right? There's no trust in that, right? Shared understanding of the solution and the outcomes, and then finally delivering on what you said you would, right? So this is all good to get a sale, but then did you actually deliver, right? That's to wrap it up. So what we put together for you is a little worksheet. I'll take any questions, but what we wanted to do is put together this little worksheet that gives you a couple prompting questions along the way here. So we put a little prompting questions here just for you to think about, right? So create the framework and like think about these things and think through this stuff. And again, it may be a little bit different if you're not selling to a person, you're selling more mass market type of stuff. I think most of you guys are selling to businesses. But even still, the process of thinking through this is still important regardless of what your business is, right? So we've gone through it, but any questions at this point? Anything you guys want to look at? It's going to turn over to you next, so if you have questions, now's a good time for it. Questions about the framework, things you agree with, disagree with? Yeah.
Well, it's more connected to the products you sell or myself when I come to invest.
This is the way to look at this is more about selling your product to a potential customer, less about pitching your company to a potential investor. So this is about how do you actually, sales is like the lifeblood of your company. Investment is great and it's important and it's necessary, but this is how you make money every day as a business, right? Right. There's lots of sessions, lots more in that. But I think what I wanted to get across here is just this whole idea of like people buying from people. And what John talked about this morning is that hook part, right? And that creates that immediate connection, but that just gets you in the door. And that's important, and it underlies a lot of it underlies everything you do, but it gets you in the door. But the next part is again, leading with something, leading with the buyer. Think about the buyer first, not your product first, right? Why do I want to buy your product? And it's not the things that you're telling me, it's the problems that I have. And it's about talking through that, listening to really asking good questions, listening and synthesizing that into how your solution actually meets their problems, right? And then backing that up, and then more procedural or logistical, figuring out the right next steps, right? So the way we want this to work is we'll take, what time is it? It is, so it's 2:45. So maybe we'll take about half hour, say 3:15. What I'd like you guys to do is take that worksheet and just start jotting down points. So you can either think about it as a customer that you've previously talked to, right? So maybe there's a customer that you sold and you can think through what some of the things and try to put it together in this framework. Or if you were gonna talk to a customer, what things would you put through here, right? So what would be the types of, so in the personal side, you know, what are the types of questions? So if you in this question, you know, we talked about if you had gone through a customer, like use one as a case study for us, but what types of things would you want to know? So if you don't have one yet and you haven't sold anything yet, that's okay. Just think about, you can make something up here, but basically think through those types of questions. Like who would be the ideal buyer there? What would be their ideal business issue, right? So think through that, like what would be their title? What company would they work at? What would be their responsibility? Who would they report to, right? Again, so you're now saying, you know, you have a product that, you know, does some amazing thing. How does that actually connect? And what would be the quantifiable value proposition? Would it save them $5 million? Would it, you know, would it get them to market quicker? Well, what is that real value proposition that you're giving? And then what can you use as benchmarks? And just, you know, list them out. Just think about, you can brainstorm. This can be okay if it's not completely right, but I just want you to sort of think through this framework a little bit. Is that okay? You guys okay? Questions? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Use your laptop, use the sheets. It's more about, I care more that you think through this stuff than you write down stuff. It's not for me, it's for you, right? But what we'll do is we'll go through this for a half hour and then give you guys a time to think about it a little bit, grab a restroom break, whatever, and then come back. And what we'll do is we'll go through each team and sort of work through this together, right? And we'll help you refine this, right? So it won't be more critique, it'll be more like, okay, here's some things to think about so that you guys can nail this, right? So when you come and get that ready, just give us a sense of, you know, what your product is, again, right? Because we've seen so many. What your product is, and give us a sense of who you're talking to as you go through this stuff. Is it an existing customer that you did previously that you're putting through this framework, or is it sort of like your idealized customer if you don't have a customer, right? And we'll be around for questions to help you answer this as well.